Hello everybody, and welcome back to the Vanquish playthrough. So, we have just about made it through all right. And we're actually coming up to the end of Act 4. And, oh boy, things are going to really very seriously hit the fan. We have 3 missions left for this act, and then we are into the end game. Complex from here.
What's a sit rep for that area? Don't know, sir. Enemy RIs are occupying the area, and we aren't getting any actionable intel.
Then we'll just figure it out when we get there.
And for anybody like me who's not really down with all of their military terminology, a sit rep is literally just a situation report. That's what I assumed, but just nice to have confirmation when it comes to that sort of stuff, you know? Now, we should be okay for a little bit, so I think it might be a good time to bring up about the soundtrack for Vanquish, seeing as we are very nearly at the end of the game, and I haven't gone anywhere near as much into detail with this blog as I thought I was going to. It's worth talking about the soundtrack. So, this particular blog post was written by the composer of Vanquish, Elena Ivana. So, as you know, Vanquish is a shooter with strong action speed elements, as the world of Vanquish is set in a science fiction imagining of the near future. They realised that the game would definitely need heavy synth elements and then went to work. With a lot of Western third-person shooter games, the soundtrack is either rarely used, or when it is used, it seems to lack punch. But one of the things that Mikami-san told them that he wanted was that Vanquish needed to have music to be the backup dancers for the game. So as the game was developed, a clear sense of speed emerged as the game's hook, so the background music had to match that. This led up to all of that up-tempo banging that you get in the game today. Even within Platinum Games, there were those who said that the soundtrack didn't sound like a shooter soundtrack, but since Vanquish is so aggressive, they made the soundtrack more along the lines of something from an action game. It's a blending of genres from techno to industrial to breaks, metal, jungle, and even there's some Hollywood-style scoring in there. Another thing that Mikami-san said was that make sure it doesn't end up PN03-esque. He said, make it a battlefield, make it militaristic. The game may look like science fiction, but the soundtrack should be gritty and warlike, because it is ultimately a war game. And having that science fiction style feel of the near future, but matching it with grittiness, is something that's very hard to pull off at the same time with music. But the tracks were taken, and genres that they were already working on, and Niwa looked at how they could add grittiness of war into the tracks. And then it was just a matter of dissecting the key ideas and reassembling them as music. Actually, when they started thinking of militarism, it reminded them of a track that they'd used in Advanced Wars, well, that had been used in the Advanced Wars commercial in Japan. And even during production, that track would pop into Niwa's head from time to time. So that's pretty much all there is on the soundtrack. You can actually buy the soundtrack, which is really quite cool. But there's only so much now. Yeah, this particular section's rather mean, because you can get so far into it, and then you can possibly die, and then pretty much most of the gorgies that are sitting on the outer parts and sniping at you, which I have now pretty much defeated, will then reappear, and you'll have to continue tackling whatever is coming your way. You tend to get a checkpoint after defeating the Romanovs, but those gorgies aren't counted in that, which is kind of insane when you think about it. And seeing as we are going to be getting quite a lot of plot towards the end of this part, it's probably a good idea to talk about narrative design. This blog post was written by J.P. Kellams, who was one of the writers for Vanquish. Normally, he did the translator jobs, but with Vanquish, he also wrote some scenes in the script. And added in most of the naming slash jargon and tried to bring that Platinum Games flavour to the script. Approaching the story was quite an interesting endeavour. It's not often that you sit in a room with the directors of Resident Evil and Code Veronica and get asked your opinion about the story. One of these points was the opposing force in the game. Initially, the candidate was actually China, but ultimately they went with Russians. Callum's noticed that some people on the net claim that Russia is clichéd as an enemy force, but it really is the only logical conclusion. Vanquish is based on an extension of our current world into the future, so the original plan of a Chinese enemy makes very little sense. China owns most of the United States' debt, and the US buys most of China's manufactured goods. When there is money to be made, people tend to find ways not to fight. Russia, on the other hand, makes perfect sense. Over half of all Russian exports to the US are petroleum products, so in a resource crunch, the economic ties that bind Russia to the US would be severed, allowing them to attack. After all, wars are essentially about resource control. Another reason that Callum's pushed for Russia as an enemy is because he really enjoys the pseudo-Cold War nostalgia that nation-on-nation conflicts, especially Russia, brings about. It's got that great G.I. Joe sense of good guys taking on bad guys, which plays directly into the style of dialogue that they were going for in Vanquish. In essence, the game is tinged with parody, but not to the point of being overt. Callum's read a review that said it's hard to tell whether it is taking the piss or not, which in itself may well be the intention. Many of the dialogue lines in Vanquish are way over the top, but then again you're talking about a group of superpowered space marines attacking a colony the size of a small city in space. I think it'd be incredibly strange if they played things overly straight-faced, so why not have fun with things? Why not make the characters aware of not only the ridiculousness of the situation, but also the varied cultural influences that led to the creation of a game like Vanquish? Kellum's intent, at least with the English script, was not fan service, but rather making sure the game never forgets what it is, a game. And stepping out of the blog post for a minute, that's actually something that I think Platinum Games tends to do perfectly. Pretty much all of their games are always very aware that they are games, and they don't necessarily try to be any more than that, and it works wonderfully. Anyway, back into this blog post. There are plenty of companies working towards the serious, but Platinum never forget that they're making games, and Kellums loves that. As that same review said, we weren't sure if we were laughing at it or with it, but we were definitely laughing, which Kellum sees as perfect. That being said, Vanquish is a bit serious. When Kellums went through the completed script outline, he realised what Hiroki Kato, who's the lead scriptwriter, had come up with was ultimately a morality tale on the frailty of one best intentions. All of the characters in Vanquish are rough around the edges, with motivations that conflict with the idealised world they are striving to create. If you read into it a bit, it draws many parallels with the attacks French philosopher Voltaire launched against fellow philosopher Gottfried Leibniz, and his concept of optimism, which links to the whole Candide thing. While Kellums doesn't think that Kato-san explicitly set out with Voltaire in mind, it was nice to be able to strengthen these parallels in some of the naming and situations in the game, so hopefully you have fun trying to find those references. Finally, on the English voice acting in the game, Kellums was incredibly privileged to work with top-notch people across the board on the English script. It was always fun to be the dumbest one in the room because you have so many people to look up to, from the editor of the script, Alexander O. Smith, to the voice director, Chris Zimmerman, who did Bayonetta and Metal Gear Solid and has done many Platinum games since, to the incredibly talented cast, like Gideon Emery, Steve Bloom, Mark Warden, who voices Zaitsev, Kari Walgren, Lee Merriweather, who voices Elizabeth Winters, Benito Martinez, who voices Professor Candide, together on the project, but they were able to pull it off and got some amazing performances. And obviously you've got all the different translations and they play, different languages for the game, which is great. What do you mean? Yes, but one thing that's actually quite important is that Mikami-san really, really, really loves Gideon's voice as Sam, and Kellums is a massive fan of the Japanese voice actor's performance for Zaitsev. So you've got a nice little balance there. And they have actually got some outtakes from the studio on the blog post if you want to have a look. Although, considering Platinum recently changed their website, you kind of have a situation where the video's kind of broken. It's kind of bad, but these things do happen when things get updated and all that jazz. But we are now in our penultimate mission for the Axe, going through this oil refinery, and it's all rather chaotic. And we are going to be coming up against a brand new enemy who is going to be very, very, very interesting. Well, first off, we've got to make it to the bottom, well, make it further into the industrial complex. And you are going to have to be keeping a very close eye on where everything is, because these guys will toss those grenades at you, and they will hurt if you get hit by them, so just be careful. But what's a really quite good idea is just stay up here until these guys up top are defeated, because the enemies won't actually be able to really hit you apart from with grenades up here, so you are pretty safe, all things considered. I mean, this is being rather cheap in terms of dealing with the mission, but to be fair, I'd rather be a little bit careful now so that I have, well, I feel a little bit more safe in the area come the fight that's about to happen, because potentially it can be a little bit challenging. Because pretty much as soon as you get down here, this brand new enemy turns up, the Crystal Viper. I have to say, I would like to know who invited this chandelier as well, because it looks ridiculous, but it's very, very threatening if you are not careful. Basically, you've just got to keep pummeling it, and you'll be okay. Dodge out the way also as much as possible, because he can be very, very, very dangerous. Now, I do quite like that not only does Sam quip that he calls by calling it a chandelier, but also lovely bit of lampshade hanging is that he quips that it's like something out of a bad video game, or I think as the quote actually went, this is starting to sound like a bad video game. Getting a little bit of that parody in there, which is quite fun. Also, that is actually glorious. If you hit Burns with the LFE gun, he will turn around at you and have a go. That's brilliant. Now, some people, well, many fans have dubbed the Crystal Viper the Silver Surfer, because it looks rather like the Silver Surfer, you know, with being a nude man made out of crystal/silver. But others have compared him to Dr. Manhattan, who also looks very similar in Watchmen, and also actually has similar abilities of being, well, very similar, in fact, of the same shade of blue. Well, not maybe the same shade, but it's a shade of blue. He's able to conjure objects out of thin air, and he's capable of manipulating energy as an attack form without any sort of weapon. There's also similarities to Electro, but Dr. Manhattan's probably your closest bet. And thankfully, we were able to take him down alright, although I was so very nearly dead there. Thank God I dodged at the right time and activated that quick time event to be able to bring the hurt just enough to be able to get as near to the end of the fight. But oh dear, there is a hole in the space station, and now everyone is going to be monumentally screwed!
Bad, Sam. There's a large hole in the outer containment wall of the colony.
A hole? Sam, you two got a way out of this one.
Our briefing said there were shelters below this area.
Affirmative. You should be able to close an internal barrier down there.
Okay, move out, Bravo!
So, yeah, we kind of need to find a way to block that hole, if we can, anyway. But we get this really, really fun mission, because we get loads of anti-gravity, or at least it's going to start to take place, which is just great fun. Because although the game has obviously been completely ridiculous, it's not actually played around with the idea of gravity yet. So it's good that they've decided to do it here.
Roger. This'll come in handy. I don't have time for this.
So the really cool thing about this sequence is that so you've got boxes flying everywhere, which I believe you can use to your advantage, because if you shoot them they will start to fly in the opposite direction. So I think you can potentially crush enemies with them, also potentially you can be screwed over by that. Because if you get caught, then you know that's probably going to hurt quite a bit as well. But it's also great fun because of obviously the curvature of the level. There's just there's a lot of variety here, or at least what feels like variety, and it's really fun. It's perhaps a little bit simple, but I mean, I suppose the main challenge that you're facing is that you're in a very enclosed space. So it's very difficult to get a real target on some of these things. And I mean, when you've got things like the Gorgies, USGs, in an enclosed space, they can be threatening. Thankfully, I'm just very on the ball for this particular mission. It doesn't happen regularly, but it happens here, and I'm glad it did, because I really do like this mission. Although, I got myself into a little bit of a tight spot there. But at least, you know, Burns and so on are taking all of the gunfire like troopers. I mean, I wish I could take that many bullets to the face. It would be incredibly helpful, but clearly the game doesn't want me to suffer through that. For whatever reason. But once we make it down to this final little area,
I'll take this.
We are going to have to face down another unknown. Now, this guy can be challenging because, you know, this is a really tight space. And also I believe that there are vents that you can, that it can climb in, because obviously it can move around the walls. It could potentially get away from you, so you've got to be careful, but then, I mean, you know, it will half the time end up focusing on your comrades, whatever. So, the fact that they are drawing attention away from it can really, 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 really help out. Also, yeah, as soon as I destroyed it, it really didn't stand much of a chance. And that is mission over, pretty much. And it's also act over, and we are going to learn a few rather surprising truths about what has been going on here. And I don't think anybody's going to come out of this all looking good. Like, it's not going to be a pleasant experience for anyone, I suspect.
What's it looking like outside?
There are still some stragglers heading for the shelter.
How much time we got left?
Not sure, but if you don't hurry, internal pressure in the colony will drop below sustainable levels.
Enough with the physics! Just shut the damn blast doors!
You can't do that. You've still got men out there.
Men who were ready to die when they signed up for this mission. You know that.
Let's not give up on them just yet. There's still time.
I don't take orders from DARPA.
How you do things.
Don't you get sentimental with me. How many people do you think have already died for this? Failure is not an option now. It never was.
So you fail those men out there instead?
What part of Marines complete the mission did you not understand? We do what has to be done. I don't pick and choose how. You go ahead. I'll make sure our rear flank is covered.
This high-speed elevator can take us right up to the enemy position.
Be the lifeline that drags the U.S. out of recession.
History should lend credence to that theory.
Even with the sacrifice of San Francisco.
I never planned for that to happen. But sacrifice of some sort is unavoidable.
This is not the time or the place for regrets.
The ends come before the means now.
Then I will let you handle the means.
And I will bring about the ends.
Let's go!